Right friends, welcome back to lecture part. This is week number 37 from 7th to 13th September. Let us look at the highlights. Unfortunate incident took place in Jabua district, that is Petlawad in Madhya Pradesh. In view of this, I would like to throw some light on Petroleum and Explosives Safety Organization. Many of you may not be aware about the existence of such institution. The next important aspect is the Prime Minister meets industry bigwigs to sort out the issues because the credit offtake is not satisfactory, the growth of manufacturing sector is not satisfactory. That's why he met the industry bigwigs. Third important point is Cabinet clears spectrum trading norms. Previously, it cleared spectrum sharing and now it cleared spectrum trading. We are going to discuss in detail about spectrum trading. Government approves a setting up of 21st Law Commission. What is the meaning of Law Commission? What is its role? We are going to discuss. Government or the Cabinet cleared two important schemes, Gold Bond Scheme as well as Gold Monetization Scheme, primarily to reduce the import of gold into the country. And what are the difficulties? These things we are going to discuss. If you look at the states, it is Annapurna Bandars, some sort of innovative concept as revealed by the Rajasthan Chief Minister Vasundhara Raje. Look into the next issue around the world, a sweeping victory for ruling party in Singapore. People's Action Party got 83 out of 89 seats, a massive victory. The victory spree is continuing since 1959. Jeremy Corbyn is the most left-wing leader, became the Labour Party leader in United Kingdom. That shows the politics ahead in the Western world. Look into the next issue, Palestinian flag to be raised on United Nations buildings. Please don't forget, Palestine is the observer state. And look into the next issue, Sania and Leander Paes raised the hopes of Olympic medal in Rio de Janeiro in 2016 by winning the doubles titles in US Open. Look into the last issue, that is QS University rankings. India for the first time reached within 200 rankings. India's IISc Bangalore topped the list with 147, followed by IIT Delhi at 179. For the first time, Indian universities or Indian educational institutions are figuring within 200 in the world. And please don't forget, MIT is at the top position. Now let us look at the events one by one. First and the foremost event which we are going to discuss today is about the Petlawad blast. Petlawad is the place in Jabua district of Madhya Pradesh, and unfortunate incident occurred, that is when the explosives were stored in the residential area, and subsequently blast occurred. Hotel is situated near the vicinity, commercial place is also there, and there around 90 people lost their lives. Residential buildings, commercial buildings collapsed like pack of cards, and the reason for it is explosives were stored in residential area and the blast resulted in massive loss of lives. Around 90 lives were lost. But we are going to throw some light on who exactly regulates these storage of explosives. For storage of explosives, one specific organization is there. The organization name is Petroleum and Explosives Safety Organization. Petroleum and Explosives Safety Organization. This is under the Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion. under the Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, that is under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. It is headquartered in Nagpur with 5 circle offices and established in the year 1898, one of the oldest organizations. Basically, it regulates and monitors the trade of explosives in the country. Basically, laws pertaining to Explosives Act of 1884, Petroleum Act of 1934, Explosives Act of 1884, Petroleum Act of 1934, and associate laws it looks into. And please remember, in the country around 256,000 premises are there which are controlled by this tiny organization. This organization, with Nagpur as the headquarters and having only 5 circle offices with a very less number of staff, is responsible for monitoring around 256,000 premises across the country. Is it possible for such a tiny organization to monitor the spread and to monitor or regulate the explosives in the country? That is the million-dollar question. And unless the organization is strengthened, these type of incidents like Petlavad, there may not be any end in this country. Right, look into the next issue, that is the Prime Minister meets industry bigwigs. The industry bigwigs, Mukesh Ambani, Cyrus Mistry, Deveshwar, Kumar Mangalam Birla, they had a discussion with the Prime Minister. The basic problem is there is not much credit offtake in the country. And whatever is happening for the past few months, they are alarming. Especially, exports are falling continuously for several months, almost for 9 months. Exports are falling. They are in the negative territory in comparison to previous year. Second important aspect is credit offtake is not satisfactory from the banking system. Normally, corporates take several loans from the banking system. Credit offtake is not satisfactory, and credit offtake has fallen to below 10%. That is the biggest worry for the Indian manufacturing sector today. And under this backdrop, the Prime Minister met the industry bigwigs and he urged them to seize the opportunities thrown up by global turmoil. World is not growing, but there is a scope for India to grow at much faster pace, probably at 10% per annum, but that is not taking place. So, under these circumstances, Prime Minister discussed, and the discussions revolved around how to push the investment, because private investment is essential for putting the GDP on track. Though the GDP is growing around 7%, but several macroeconomic statistics are not supporting that view. Because of that reason, Prime Minister discussed about how to push investment, how to boost infrastructure spending, how to promote the startups, and how to lower the cost of capital. Right? So, let us hope for some breakthrough with massive private investment in the near future. Unless private investment comes up in this country, it is not possible to create that many jobs required for the youth graduating out of colleges in the country. Look at the next issue, Cabinet clears spectrum trading. Previously, government allowed spectrum sharing. Spectrum means airwaves at particular frequency. Airwaves of a particular wavelength, or you can say airwaves at particular frequency constitutes particular band, and certain frequencies are allotted to various telecom companies, and some telecom companies may have spare spectrum, some telecom companies may be congested, some telecom companies may have spare airwaves, and some telecom companies congested their airwaves because of the reason call drops are taking place. When you are talking over phone, sometimes the phone gets disconnected, that is a call drop. So sometimes call drops takes place because of the reason busy in the spectrum. or you can say congestion in the airwaves. And some telecom companies may have spare spectrum. Previously, government allowed sharing of airwaves. Two telecom companies can share airwaves. That was previously adopted, previously cleared by the government. But now, government cleared spectrum trading. What is the meaning of spectrum trading? The telecom company which has spare airwaves can sell to the telecom company which is in need of airwaves. The telecom company which has spare airwaves can sell to the telecom company which is in need of airwaves. And this is a spectrum trading. Spectrum sharing is sharing of airwaves by two telecom companies. Spectrum trading is buying and selling of a spectrum by one telecom company with the other. And the ultimate ownership lies with the government of India. But here, because of spectrum sparing and spectrum trading, what will happen? It will lead to optimization of frequencies, because of which there will be fewer call drops. Call drops will be reduced because of optimization of airwaves. So please don't forget, government allowed spectrum sparing, spectrum trading, which will result in optimization of airwaves, ultimately will result in better utilization of airwaves, in turn reduction in call drops, that means better services to the customers. Right, remaining things, you can go through this PPT. Government approves setting up of 21st Law Commission. You may ask, what is Law Commission? Law Commission is the advisory body to the Ministry of Law and Justice. It is advisory body and it is a non-statutory body. It is advisory body, it is a non-statutory body, originally constituted in the year 1955. Originally constituted in the year 1955 with a time period of 3 years. Every time this Law Commission is constituted with a time period of 3 years, the term of 20th Law Commission ended on 31st August 2015, and from 1st September, government approved setting up of 21st Law Commission. So government approved setting up of 21st Law Commission for a period of 3 years from 1st September 2015, and it will have one full-time chairperson and 4 full-time members, please don't forget. And you may ask, what is the purpose of a Law Commission? All of you are well aware, several times delay in judgments take place, basically to suggest government with regard to the measures to be taken for eliminating delays, for speedy disposal of cases, for reduction in cost of litigation. Keeping these 3 things in mind, Law Commission advises Ministry of Law and Justice. Please don't forget. So, 21st Law Commission is announced by the government and the names are yet to be announced. Look into the item economy and banking. Cabinet cleared gold bond scheme and gold monetization scheme. This sovereign gold bond scheme and gold monetization scheme, these 2 schemes were cleared by the cabinet. Only draft guidelines are available. Final guidelines are not available. That's why different papers interpreted the guidelines in different way. And these are not sacrosanct. Final guidelines will be given by the government, but I have taken from that draft and I would like to explain what is exactly the meaning of sovereign gold bond scheme and gold monetization scheme. Sovereign gold bond scheme. You want to purchase some 50 grams of gold. instead of purchasing gold, you will be given bond. Instead of physical gold, you will be given gold bond. You will pay for gold, you will get the gold bond. And the term is from 5 to 7 years, and interest also will be given on that. And instead of buying physical gold, you will purchase gold bonds. These gold bonds will be in the denominations of 5 grams, 10 grams, 50 grams and 100 grams. These are all draft guidelines. And a person can have a maximum of 500 grams of gold bonds per year. That means if someone has got intention to purchase gold, instead of physical gold, he will get gold bond. What is the advantage? I will tell you a little later. So, instead of physical gold, he will get gold bond. Right? The second issue is gold monetization scheme. What is gold monetization scheme? Basically, you will take out the gold that may be in the form of jewelry. Jewelry means ornaments. Maybe in the form of bullion, and you will deposit that gold with the bank. You will deposit that gold with the bank. Bank, after the agreed period may be 1 year to 15 years. After the agreed period, you can take back the equal quantity of gold. Suppose you have deposited 50 grams of gold. After 3 years, you can take back 50 grams of gold, or you can take back cash with some interest. There are two options. After depositing gold with the bank, after the agreed period, you can take back gold, but not your jewelry. If you have deposited 50 grams of jewelry, after 3 years or 4 years, you can get 50 grams of gold in coin form or bar form, not your jewelry form. Or you can take money from the bank with some interest. So, there are two options. That means the jewelry, instead of lying idle in your home, can be deposited to bank. Bank in turn will give it to some jewelers. And the main purpose of this scheme is the idle gold lying in the households should be brought, and that should be given to the jewelers so as to reduce the imports of gold into the country. Right? Here, the gold purity will be decided, and subsequently, whatever the gold you give to the bank will go to some jeweler. Right? So, this is about the gold monetization scheme. That means instead of gold staying in your house, will be brought out, and through bank, it will be given to some jeweler by the bank for preparing or for manufacturing further jewelry. And after the agreed period, you will get back gold or money, but not your jewelry. So, this is about gold monetization scheme. Right? And these two schemes, gold bond scheme as well as gold monetization scheme, are basically intended to curb the gold imports. In India, we are purchasing around 800 to 1000 tons of gold every year. Every year, our consumption is around 800 to 1000 tons of gold, and we are competing with China in consumption of gold. And government wants to reduce this gold consumption because of the reason. Almost the entire quantity is imported from other countries. Because of imports, it is costing us precious foreign exchange, and it is putting pressure on current account deficit. Our import bill is going day by day because of gold imports. So, gold comes under non-essential import. What is the difference between essential import and non-essential import? Essential imports are like petroleum products. You cannot stop it. Non-essential imports are like gold. You can stop, you can control them. So, government wants to control non-essential imports like gold. With that in mind, to bring out the gold from the homes, this gold monetization scheme was brought, and at the same time gold bond scheme was also brought with a view to control the demand for physical gold. That's why gold bond will be given there. And here, once the customer deposits gold, he will have option to take back gold or money after the agreed period. The basic purpose of these two schemes is to reduce import of gold into the country. And remaining things I have given in this PPT is, these are all draft guidelines, but look at this. What are the advantages? Advantages are, there is no fear of theft. If you are keeping gold in your almara, you may be having a fear of theft. Second is, no locker charges. You need not keep your gold in lockers. Directly, you can surrender it to the bank. Third one is, you can stay at home with mental peace. But what are the problem areas? Especially with Indian psychology, and especially with the sentiment of women in this country, it is not that easy for gold monetization scheme to be successful. I listed out 6 points as problem areas which are coming in the way of success of this gold monetization scheme and gold bond scheme. Look at the first one. Indians are culturally and traditionally attached with the gold jewelry. People are attached with the gold jewelry. Parting with it may be very difficult. Indian women certainly may not agree to it. Second thing is, melting gold jewelry may be against the sentiment of Indian woman. When I am giving my jewelry to the bank, what the bank will do? Bank will give that jewelry to some jeweler. In turn, jeweler, what he will do? Jeweler will melt that gold and prepare fresh ornaments or new ornaments. Probably Indian psychology may not accept to it. Third one is, lot of wastage is involved. If I am surrendering gold, especially jewelry, lot of wastage will be there. And when I am repurchasing, and if I want to make jewelry once again, lot of wastage will be there in the making charges as well as wastage. Fourth one is, whatever the interest banks are claiming to give, they have not yet revealed because they are only draft stage, but the interest rate may not be high. Fifth one is, why people invest in gold bonds when other financial products are giving better results, like bonds, like share market investments, mutual fund investments. When they are giving better results, why people purchase gold bonds? They will postpone the purchase of gold. Subsequently, they will purchase later. And the last one is, wearing jewelry is considered to be social status in this country. Wearing jewelry is considered to be social status in this country, and because of which people may not be willing to surrender gold under gold monetization scheme. So these are the problem areas for these things to become successful. So please don't forget, this draft guidelines will be implemented shortly, and let us hope government to get some reprieve with these two schemes so as to reduce imports into the country across the states. Rajasthan Chief Minister announced that they will start Annapurna Bhandars, an innovative concept. As stated by the Chief Minister, the present ration shops stock only wheat, sugar and kerosene. But the Chief Minister says, in future, around 150 products will be sold at regulated prices by the government through this Annapurna Bhandars. 150 commodities will be sold at regulated prices at these Annapurna Bhandars, as stated by the Rajasthan Chief Minister. And other important aspect is, government will rebrand 5,000 out of total 25,000 ration shops. In Rajasthan, there are around 25,000 ration shops, and out of 25,000, 5,000 will be rebranded, and they will be rebranded under public-private partnership model by designating them as Annapurna Bhandars to stock 150 items, and they will be sold at regulated prices. And another important aspect as claimed by the Chief Minister is home delivery and online platform for these ration shops. And this existing Bhamasha card holders will have option to take cash as subsidy or non-cash goods. So this Annapurna Bhandars, Rajasthan government would like to implement in innovative way. Let us hope Rajasthan government will walk the talk. That means they will implement as claimed by the Chief Minister of Rajasthan. Look at the next one around the world. Sweeping victory for ruling party in Singapore, Singapore's People's Action Party. This party was founded in 1954 by the founding father of Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew, who died recently. And this party is in power since 1959. And this People's Action Party got a massive mandate this time, getting around 70% of the votes. And the Prime Minister is Lee Hsien Loong, is the Prime Minister of Singapore. He is the son of founding father of Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew, right? So the victory indicates the faith imposed by the Singapore citizens on the policies undertaken by the People's Action Party over the past 50 to 60 years, right? So look into the next one. Jeremy Corbyn, new Labour Party leader in United Kingdom. Elections were held recently in United Kingdom. David Cameron, Conservative Party leader, got elected as the Prime Minister. Ed Miliband, Labour Party leader, lost. And subsequently, Ed Miliband resigned. And now, as the head of Labour Party, as Labour Party chief, left-wing ideology, Jeremy Corbyn got elected. Jeremy Corbyn got around 60% of first preference votes, and he is the person with the leftist ideas, and his ideas include he is against United Kingdom's military intervention overseas. United Kingdom participates in military interventions in several countries in the Middle East, and he is against these policies. Second is, he is for nuclear disarmament completely. And the other important aspect is, he is for withdrawal of British from NATO. NATO is the military bloc of countries which was established in 1949, and UK is one of the member of NATO, and his left-wing policies are quite radical. And one of the most left-wing leaders in the world at present. And Jeremy Corbyn is the person with the most leftist ideology which the United Kingdom has ever had till date. And he is now 65 years, but he has to wait for another 4 to 5 years to contest the elections. And if he wins, he will become one of the oldest prime ministers at the age of 70 years in the year 2020. Because in Britain, parliamentary elections are held once in 5 years. Recently, elections were held and David Cameron was elected as the prime minister, and he belongs to Conservative Party, and now Jeremy Corbyn is the leader of the Labour Party. Look into the next one. Palestinian flag to be raised on UN buildings. United Nations buildings. What is so special about it? Previously, member countries are only allowed to raise their flags in the United Nations buildings. Previously, member countries were only allowed, but United Nations has got two observer states also. The two observer states are One is Palestine, second one is Vatican. One is Palestine, second one is Vatican. Now, in the United Nations General Assembly, voting was done and 119 voters voted in favor of allowing the observer states to raise their flags in UN buildings. 119 countries voted for, 8 nations voted against, which include, as usual, Israel and United States of America. America is the ally of Israel, and 45 countries abstained from voting. Right? And this shows that there is overwhelming support for the Palestine cause in the world. So now Palestine flag will fly on the UN buildings as voted in United Nations General Assembly. And please don't forget, the Palestine and Vatican, these two are the observer states in United Nations. We will discuss in detail about United Nations in our news analysis sometime later, right? Look into the next one, sports and games. Sania Mirza and Leander Paes made India proud, and this raises hopes about Olympic medals in Rio de Janeiro in 2016. Look at the performance of Sania Mirza. She won the US Open doubles with Martina Hingis of Switzerland, and this is her second consecutive Grand Slam victory. Not only that, so far she has won 5 Grand Slam titles. And look at Leander Paes at the age of 42 years. Leander Paes partnered with Martina Hingis to win the mixed doubles in United States Open, and this is his third title this year. Third Grand Slam title this year, and overall he won 17 Grand Slam titles. And now there is a hope in the country that definitely India is in for Olympic medals in Rio de Janeiro Olympics. And if you look at the men's singles winner, Novak Djokovic of Serbia, continuing his winning spree. And women's singles, the fight was between two Italians. Finally, Flavia Pennetta won the women's title. And women's doubles, I have told you, there's Sania Mirza and Martina Hingis. And men's doubles has gone to France pair, right? That is Pierre Hugues Herbert and Nicolas Mahut of France defeated the pair of Britain and Australia, right? So this is about US Open, which concluded recently. Last but not the least is QS World University Rankings. India, for the first time, two Indian institutions made it to the top 200. And if you ask the 5 institutions in the world, top 5 institutions, MIT of United States of America, Massachusetts Institute of Technology is at the first rank, Harvard University is second rank, these two are United States of America based. Cambridge University came at the third place. This is UK based, followed by Stanford and Caltech. Caltech is California Institute of Technology. So out of top 5 institutions in the world, 4 belongs to United States of America. That shows the technological might of United States of America. And India, for the first time, reached within top 200. From the Indian perspective, it is the biggest achievement, because till date we are beyond 200. And India's Indian Institute of Science Bangalore is at 147th place, and IIT Delhi at 179, followed by IIT Bombay at 202, IIT Madras at 254, and IIT Kanpur at 271. So all the 5 reputed institutions of the country are standing between 147 to 271. Let us hope some Indian institution to come within 100 next year. Right, friends, with this, let us conclude lecture part of week number 37. And Please do join for news analysis and features. We are going to discuss about how the monetary policies of advanced economies affecting the emerging markets or emerging economies, and what is wrong with Eritrea. These two things we are going to discuss this week under news analysis and features, and have a nice day. Thank you.